This operation, Heather, that's Bourne.
Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you gonna give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is October 13th, 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern on the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, which now runs 24/7, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. And don't forget, just because we're 24/7 and we're broadcasting, always broadcasting, we're broadcasting old shows and live shows, don't forget about the new shows that you have missed, and you can always go back to any of those websites and just listen to one of the recent shows or one of the shows from whenever. Spreaker actually has every show we've ever done. As I've noticed, a lot of people just listening to the live feed, whatever's playing, which is fine too, but just remember that you can go back and listen to the most recent show or, you know, the shows from last week or the past couple days. Or, again, Spreaker has every show we've ever done. So hopefully you won't go back too far where I was, like, terrible. But, you know, you can go back maybe a year and it's pretty good. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are always happy to hear from you. And you can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. It has all our contact information as well if you forget the phone number or the Skype username. But it also has links to all our social media, including our Facebook and Twitter pages. It has original articles and blogs. It has a whole bunch of archives, not all of them, but sometimes I get behind on that. There's still a bunch I have to add, but it has a lot of our archives there, as well as pictures and other information. So be sure to check us out there and the specific URL to any of our sites if you want to see where you can find the archives. It will give you the specific URL as for the live streams and for the archives, as opposed to me just naming the site. Although, if you type in Nonpartisan Liberty for All or our other show, The Illumination Hour, they'll come up. So you can always do that. But if you want to have the actual URL, you can find it there. So tonight, we're going to talk about something a little different, but not really. And I kind of came up with this last minute. And I was going to do a show about Sandy Hook. And I believe we've talked, I know we've talked about it in the past. I don't know if we did a dedicated show to it. But if we did, there's a lot of stuff that I know we left out. Today, I was listening to a bunch of documentaries and the information in those documentaries, as well as there's a government report that was done by, I think it was the Connecticut State Police, that it refers to. So it's not, you know, some of it is coming to conclusions based on facts, but it's obvious to me that the story we got, there's a lot of holes in it. And before I had said that when I talked about Sandy Hook in the past, but not to the point where I started thinking that it possibly was even a hoax, where that these kids didn't really die. And now I don't know. And I need to do more research. And that's why I didn't do the show today, because I didn't want to come on without enough information and feeling comfortable about that information and talk about it. I want to have more time to go through their report and check other sources. I have looked at it in the past, but I want to check more sources than just what I looked at in the past and what I listened to today. And I want to look at that report as well. But I do know that there was this is what I had mentioned before, a investigator of, that's what he did. He investigated like school safety or something. I don't recall his exact title. I think he was, his last name was Halibut or something. I can't remember his first name. But that's what he used to do. And he was retired and he started looking into Sandy Hook just to see what happened. Not necessarily that he thought there was some conspiracy or something, but he just wanted to look into, okay, what were the issues there? And they, by that time, I think they had demolished the school. They kept all this information from him that were just freedom of information requests that anybody can get. It was public information. He was threatened by the police, and I believe he lives in Florida, and I'm not sure if the Connecticut State Police went to Florida or called the Florida State Police and had them go to his house in Florida. But he believed something happened because they totally tried to throw him off of getting any information or anything. They didn't want him to have anything to do with it. And being that he's someone that was a trained investigator, he was also a former police officer. And he's just looking into this, which, again, it's not that he was trying to get information that other people can't get, although there shouldn't be any information that you don't have access to, really. You know, I know there's certain classified information that has to do with, okay, if they're going to attack, you know, secret attacks on like a terrorist group or CIA agents that are undercover or whatever. But something like this that's over, there shouldn't be any information that the public can't get access to about it, because it's done. It happened. There shouldn't be anything that is hidden. That's that whole, it's so funny that Obama talked about having the most transparent presidency ever, and he probably was the least. But I don't even put that on him. I put that on, that's what you're going to see. I think the next president will be even less transparent than him, and then it will keep going forward that you'll see less and less transparency. Just the same way where you could say that he was the worst on something, like the spying or whatever. Well, he's not going to be the worst on spying because the next president will be the worst. And then the next prep, because it's just going to get worse and worse. And we're going to talk a little about that tonight as well. But I just wanted to mention that I had planned on doing that show on the Sandy Hook shootings. And there's just so much information that I don't even know if it was at this point. Like before, I just thought, okay, the story they're telling is not true. There was definitely more than one shooter because it was impossible for that little kid to pull off the shooting. What would you call it? The target ratio or the hit ratio, whatever that he pulled off. And he's a small kid and carrying all that stuff. And, you know, so definitely I had thought that there were other people involved and there were things that the public wasn't being told because there were a lot of weird things with that whole thing. And it came up last night, and that's what made me think of it. Ken Georgian, who joins us every other week, check him out at Daily Economist and on YouTube at Ken Georgian is his channel. But he had brought that up, and I had mentioned the Orlando shooting in the nightclub, same thing, that there's no way that one shooter could have pulled it off. And one of the things that I had mentioned before and Ken had mentioned last night as well in the Orlando shooting at the nightclub was that the SWAT team killed a bunch of the people, not necessarily on purpose. I'm not even saying something like that, but that it was weird. And I had talked about this, the timing and how there's like he's holding hostages and the timeline. And there's a lot of holes in that, too. So I don't necessarily think that had anything to do with a setup of government involvement or anything. That could have just been, you know, them coming in and fucking up and shooting a bunch of people. Or it could have been they were ordered to shoot a bunch of people. So it would be they could say it was the worst shooting in history or something. So I don't know. But I do know with that, there's same thing. There's no way that that guy could have pulled off the amount of targets that he was able to hit. It's just it's physically impossible. I mean, not even a trained sharpshooter could have pulled that off. So same thing with Adam Lanza and Sandy Hook. So I originally just thought, okay, you know, this actually happened, but they're not telling us a bunch of stuff and there were other shooters and who knows if Adam Lanza was even the one who did it, but there were other people involved. And come to find out, they had like seven different suspects and there was a guy who was out in camouflage and that they had handcuffed for a little while and then let go. He was supposedly one of the parents. And this is all stuff that the media covered. So there's a lot of stuff there that just does not make sense. And you've seen one thing that nobody can deny is how Obama and his minions jumped all over that prior to the election, he didn't even mention guns. Then after Sandy Hook, that was their thing and how he trotted kids out on stage and how he tried to exploit the fuck out of that. I've never seen, they all do it. So don't get me wrong, but that had to be the most exploitation of an event that I've seen. Now, not to say that I've seen a lot because I used to not pay close attention or as close attention to things like that as I do now. Although I used to watch, you know, I talked about yesterday, I used to watch, you know, the Fox News and MSNBC and yell at both of them because I hated them both. And I would watch shows that I hated just so I could disagree with them and, you know, tell them, well, to the TV what fucking morons they were. But there's definitely stuff there. So I want to at least do some more research before I talk about it on air. I mean, I had talked about this week, I believe, you know, how it's, or last week, how it's hard because I, you know, I do have my full-time job and everything, and I want to do more stories that are based on, you know, a factual information that has to be researched, as opposed to just giving my opinion based on, you know, factual information, but factual information like, you know, the government taxes you and that's extortion. I mean, that's not something I have to put a lot of research into. It's just the definition of extortion, you know, or talk about my, you know, what government really is and what they do in general. I mean, that's something I don't need any research for. It's something I know like the back of my hand. I can't believe I just used that as a, not an analogy, but whatever. I know there's a name for that. Anyway, so I would have liked to have done that tonight, but most likely sometime next week I will do that and make sure I at least have a certain amount of information before I go. And even though I do have a legitimate amount of information, but for something like this, I think I need more than what I have. And I don't want to, again, come out and come to conclusions without having more information and support. And so I can, you know, go through and say, you know, okay, well, this and validate a lot of those things too. So anyway, tonight, that doesn't mean that we're not going to have a good show. Tonight, we're going to talk about a few things. We're going to talk about the future, including robots. We're going to focus more on robots and specifically human robots, meaning, and I guess there's no such thing as human robots, but robots that look and act like humans. The getting to a point of being able to create and develop a robot that you couldn't tell the difference, and the ramifications of that. As far as where they're at, I know there's been so much progress with robots. They have a lot of military robots and stuff like that, but these aren't, you know, the military robots, they don't look like people that we know of. I mean, who knows? They could have those already and we just don't know about them. You know, who knows, really? But there are a lot of quote-unquote robots that, you know, automate things and do different things and do things for the military. And I remember seeing different videos of robots that DARPA is, of course, investing in, because DARPA, you know, builds military robots. So all these companies are getting seed money to develop robots that are basically going to be used in war. But I'm talking more about robots that are made to be human. And there's a couple shows. One I didn't mention in the description that I just thought of now. There was a show, I think it was called Humans or Human, and there were a bunch of robots that were linked that the creator actually put his brain into a robot, so he was more partially human, and the rest of them were robots, and you could tell they weren't to the point where they were human enough, most of them. Well, sort of. I was thinking of one specific one that definitely couldn't really come off that human, but some of them could. So there was that, and they had one season. I don't know if it was a Netflix original or it was BBC or something like that. I watched it on Netflix one season. It was interesting. I don't know if they plan on coming up with more episodes. But the other one is Westworld, which just debuted on HBO a couple weeks ago. Now, that has a big cast of stars. Anthony Hopkins is in it. The guy that's in a bunch of movies that I can't think of his name. But he was in HBO's, the one that took place on Boardwalk Empire. He was in that. And he was in Syriana, the black guy from Syriana with George Clooney. I can't think of his name right now. But anyway, he's in it. James Marsden's in it. And I think there's a couple other people that are in it. Ed Harris. So there's a whole bunch of, Hollywood stars that are in the show. So they probably had a big budget for that one. Although cable shows, from what I hear, they don't pay a lot. So who knows? Maybe they're not taking a lot of money. And I'm surprised that they got Anthony Hopkins. He is getting towards the end of his life. So maybe he just really liked the show and the scripts and decided to do it. So anyway, that show is based on, and we'll talk about this later, but just to give a quick description of the show, and I've watched the first two episodes. They created like a vacation town, and it's more than a town because it's pretty big. It's based on the Old West, and that's where I guess the name, Westworld comes from. I don't know how big it is. But what happens is they go through this room, from there, and they can pick guns and clothes and all that shit. And they go through this door, and the guns must have special bullets in them because people can't hurt other guests there, although I guess they could still hurt them by hitting them, but they can't shoot them, and the robots can't shoot the guests. So, and I think I'm getting ahead of myself here. So anyway, this world, or town, but it could be bigger than that. We haven't really got to how big it is yet in watching the series. There's only been two episodes so far, but they traveled pretty far in the last episode. But it also has that girl that she's pretty she's cute. I think she's English. She's light skinned, black, English. Was in played Terrence Howard's wife in that movie that it's not Drive. It's I don't know. I can't think of her name right now. But she's cute. She's she plays a prostitute in it. But anyway, so people pay to go to this world. We'll just call it a world because maybe it's a lot bigger than we know of. So in the world, you have the guests that are humans that pay to go there, and they can do whatever they want to there's robots there. So the whole town's inhabited by, or the world's all robots, but they're robots that are human-like. They're just as, you can't tell. And the people go there to vacation because they can do whatever they want there to the robots. In a way, it's kind of sadistic because they can shoot and kill the robots. There's a whorehouse there, so they can have sex with them. So they're totally you know, like I said, they're totally like humans as far as physically and everything. And mentally, the programming as well, they're just like humans. So they go there, I guess they pay whatever amount, and then they do what they want. But the humans can't kill other humans, so there's got to be something with the bullets. They haven't explained that yet. But I was just thinking, like, they could attack other people. They could still kill them with, like, a knife or something, if maybe they don't have knives that could cut through regular people. I don't know. Somehow they have it set up where they just do whatever they do to the robots. And then after they get killed, they bring them back and then repair them. And there's not much repair. I don't even think I'd call it repair. They just do whatever they do and then put them back out there. So that's the premise of the show. So we'll get into that in a little more detail later in our show. But I wanted to start with and focus on just robots that would be human robots, that would, the same concept of a robot that has not only physically, you know, they have all the attributes that a human would have. And like in Terminator, it was, say, like that. If you haven't seen Terminator, it was all human tissue basically just grown over. The only difference in a Terminator, or in at least Arnold Schwarzenegger's Terminator, there were other Terminators that had other things going on. But the only difference was that their bones really were metal. So it was like human tissue, muscle, blood, and they didn't feel pain, of course, as well. But over like a robot skeleton, a metal skeleton. So you couldn't tell that they were robots physically. Of course, you could tell just by the way they acted, but that's the other thing. Having robots that are have the ability to learn, and that's they did too, the Terminator, you know, that he was a learning computer, and that I think they're more advanced on currently than the actual human tissue part. But with science and what they're getting into with all of these things and being able to, you know, the way they do operations now and the nanotechnology and that type of stuff, that I don't think that's far away. I don't know how close that is. You know, now people have built robots, but they're not human tissue. So I'm more talking about getting to the point, which I don't think there's any doubt that this will happen, are cyborgs, basically, that they act human, they look human, they have all the attributes of a human, except they're not human. They're robots. So the only difference would probably be, like I said, the you know, the bones would be, I guess you could make bones like human bones. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but that they'd have metal bone structure and their brains would be computer chips as opposed to, you know, actual brain tissue. But I guess they could probably grow. I mean, there's so much stuff that they're going to be able to do. I mean, I'm sure they could grow brain tissue and put it in a cyborg body, so you have that as well. And I didn't really think about that because there's those two different things. So I don't know that I want to get into the specifics of how they create them, whether they're using brain human tissue or a CPU or whatever, which would be they would probably want to use anyway, as opposed to human brain, unless they could use real human tissue for the brain and one, protect it, and two, be able to advance it, because that would be the whole point of having a CPU or having a that's just what they called it in Terminator, actually. He's like, I'm a CPU, I'm a learning computer. CPU wouldn't be the thing that is in there, but like a processor or whatever they put in there for a brain. So we're going to make the assumption for the purposes of this discussion that they are able to learn like humans, and how they do it, you know, I'm not going to get into that, but they have actual human tissue. So, or synthetic human tissue, but it feels the same. It would be, all that shit would be the same, like in Terminator. So how that would affect different things. So, of course, the first thing that comes up, although I didn't have it listed first, I should have, is how would that affect relationships and sex? The first thing I had actually were jobs, but that's really way before. I mean, that's happening now. Automation and jobs don't need human-like robots. However, when it gets to that point, that eliminates a whole bunch of stuff. The computer automation where they're able to automate, you know, the screens and things like that, and possibly assembly lines are totally automated and those things. Not possibly. I mean, they are, but I mean, I'm thinking like fast food restaurants where you have an assembly line type thing that, to make a hamburger, where you don't need people to do it. But you wouldn't need a robot that looks like a human. But I'm talking about the jobs once you get to humans or robots that you can't tell the difference. So we'll get to that in a minute, though. First, we'll get to the most important thing to everybody that they're probably thinking about is relationships and, of course, sex. So, I mean, there's definitely positives to the sex part. I would definitely say that, because, you know, if you have fucking rapist, or although they say rape is a crime of violence, not of sex, but, you know, all of these, you know, people that get prostitutes, and, you know, it would put prostitutes out of work, which I think would be a good thing. Although I support, you know, I think prostitution should be legal. I was actually just watching a documentary on the sex trade, which I think is another thing that government causes, especially with for people that come over from other countries, because that's an immigration thing, because part of the reason why they stay is because they're scared that they have nowhere to go or nobody to go to, because they can't go like to the embassy or to the U.S. government or something like that. Now, they might be scared no matter what, but they're even more scared because they'll get deported, and they don't want that to happen either. And they have nowhere to go. But I think it would definitely, you know, between legalizing prostitution and having different immigration laws, you would greatly reduce the amount of harm that comes to women the way things are now. And that, and I think, you know, guns, that guns should be more accessible, you know, and if you're a prostitute, you should carry a fucking gun. I would just think that is just a given, man. but that's a whole nother issue. So anyway, but I think if they could make like sex bots that were you know, androids that, or cyborgs or whatever you want to call them, and people could have sex with them and it would be like having sex with a real human, that there's some positives to that. Now, the issue that comes up, though, and this is going to come up with everything, is what happens when, you know, talking about these robots being human-like, what about them developing emotions? Now, they can act like they have emotions. They can be programmed to learn and act like they have emotions. And that's where you can get into the other thing, of course, a relationship. And this is something that I think people would stop. This could stop, you know, people from having kids, basically. But a lot of people just, you know, would still want kids. But what I mean is that people could program, you know, first of all, they could get girls that were much better looking than what they could get in human girls, and they could program them to be how they want, you know, have the whatever interests and, you know, worship them or whatever. So I think that's going to be the first industry, really, of course, besides the military, but at least consumer industry that gets more. I mean, they're already trying to do it. There's, like I said, there's I saw some of the robots that people have created, and they don't look real enough. And I'm sure people would still have sex with them because, you know, some guys will fuck anything. But, you know, some guys will fuck a hole in the wall or a vacuum cleaner, I guess. But they, I think, would be like, you know, and I know it's going to sound like bad to women, but I think women would end up doing the same thing too. It'd be like, why don't we? I don't think it would just be a men's thing, but they would say, well, I don't have to deal with, you know, all this, all the bullshit, and I can just have a girl who, you know, does whatever I want and just gives me sex whenever I want. And there's a movie kind of like that, Cherry 2000, that came out in the late 80s, and Melanie Griffith was in it. And they had basically these robots, and they had their personality on a chip. And then what happened was this guy's robot, who was his girlfriend, essentially, not essentially, I mean, it was his girlfriend. She somehow shorted out, and he had to go into, you know, this was supposed to be in the future, this dangerous zone, to go find another one to put a chip in. And what happens is he ends up I don't want to ruin the movie, but whatever, you're probably won't watch it, but he ends up falling in love with Melanie Griffith, who's the bounty hunter who helps him to go get it, and leaves the Cherry 2000 there because there's not enough. They take off on a plane and they're, you know, being shot at, and they can't take both of them. So he leaves the robot and takes Melanie Griffith. But, you know, of course, it's trying to make a point. I mean, robots are robots, but how far does it go? So when robots develop emotions and develop their own personalities and go beyond, that's where, you know, it changes a lot of things. So that would obviously affect that whole thing. I think that's something that is definitely going to happen in the future. How long it will last, I don't know. And it goes the same with robots taking over, because robots can process more. They'll be able to process more information. They'll be smarter. They'll be stronger. You know, all of these things. And if they develop their own personality and ego and lust for power or whatever, or they're programmed that way, which I'm sure that will happen. And of course, you have transhumanism, which I'll talk a little about, but we've done shows on that before, as has the Illumination Hour recently. Ellen did a show on transhumanism, so I'm not going to talk too much about that. But it's going to be interesting to see, you know, how far that goes, really, from robots being controlled by the people that created them to them becoming like humans. And then, like in that show, Humans, that I talked about, they were trying to capture them. Some doctor or something, or in the police were helping and whatever. But people helped them because they looked at them as, they started to look at them as people, not just robots, because they, you know, then you get into what really defines a person compared to, I wouldn't say compared to an animal, because animals have feelings as well. They just can't, they don't have the, obviously, the intelligence of a human, but they still have emotions and, you know, can feel things like love and whatever, but that doesn't make them, you know, they're not humans neither. So, because they don't have a brain where they can consciously, you know, they're driven basically by instinct for the most part. They can't really make conscious decisions, not on a high level. So what really makes somebody human, and then what happens with that? And then from there, do people, you know, start freeing the robots? And then there's a movement to free the robots. They're, you know, and the, not the Coen brothers, the brothers who did the Matrix movies, one of the movies that they did where they were going through past and future lives. One of them was, dealt with that, with robot androids or whatever that were, you know, like humans, but they were robots. And you looked at it and felt bad for the way they were treated. And one of the guys actually rescued one of the robots. And so that's something that at some point I believe will come into play as well. And then what happens? I mean, do we end up at some point in a society where robots are just like another species of people, really? Not humans, but people. And that their sophistication as it, you know, the technology increases and somebody is able to create a robot that is totally, their brain functions totally like a human. And I don't think that is that far away. And what happens at that point? Because do you consider them slaves? if they're able to think like humans and you're programming them and telling them what to do, and are they able to break that programming, or does somebody create one that just isn't, they create the original program, but that you cannot break that program, that they create a robot that its brain is as close to a human as possible. That is exactly, we'll say exactly like a human. And they cannot be, well, I guess you could always be reprogrammed, but let's say, we look at encryption and things like that that we have now. Imagine by that point. So if there's no way to do anything and to change them, and they'll always be that way, they just like another person that doesn't age, I guess, and doesn't, I guess if it's tissue, human tissue, you could create them to, where they're born and they age. And I mean, I'm not up on all the, I'm not a big, say, science fiction person, except for the fact of the government type technology and things to control people in the future and all of that, and looking at the future from a government wants to control everybody, like a 1984, or yesterday we had mentioned the movie Equilibrium, where they had people take drugs to make them equal. So then you have kind of changing the subject a little, but you have jobs, of course. So initially, same thing. It's for a company, they could buy a bunch of robots that are human-like that could work at, the service industry. If they even have to do that. I mean, the way I think the service industry is going initially is more just automation through like screens and things like that. But they could have robots take the place of a human job where you need an actual human. However, again, I think that in a way that's already happening, and a lot of places don't really need humans. But what about jobs like, I was thinking about even like actors or reporters, or even sports. I think sports, people wouldn't want to see that because you have programmed. I know on the, it's funny, on the Jetsons, they had robot football players. All the football players were robots. But that you wouldn't, if you wouldn't know, right, if you went to see a movie and you don't know that the actors are robots, what the fuck does it matter? I mean, they're already doing shit right now with, computers to have, they'll take scenes from an old movie and then be able to generate that person into something new. And there's just so much you can do on computers now with images anyway. So with actors, I don't even know that you'd need robot actors. You might, with graphics, and I wasn't even thinking of this when I wrote that down, but with graphics and the way that that's going, they get more human-like all the time. So you could get to a point where you don't need actors anymore because you can just, do it all out with computer graphics and it will look like actual humans. Now, from the voice part, They do have already. They've had it for a while, but the one I have is really sucky. On one of the screenwriting programs, like, it will read your script, but it sounds like a computer. But I'm sure that will improve as well. So you probably at some point will see movies, because the price, the cost to make a movie will go down to, you know, barely anything. But it might still go to you have actors doing the voices. But at some point, it will definitely, I think, go to, there won't be actors. Sports is something that I think you'll never have a robot replace, because people want to see. Sports is something that is actually, in a way, there are a lot of things that are deep to sports, at least in certain circumstances. And in, like, that's why I like college football better than the pros. I didn't used to, but pro football, I hate supporting the NFL. They support fucking, you know, bullshit political causes and all of that shit. At least college football, you know, I'm supporting kids that are going to school, and I can justify that, even though the schools are way too much money and they're probably getting a brainwashed education. But once you get to that level, once you get to the college level, you know, if you are homeschooled your whole life and you already have all your ideas are formed to, well, to a certain extent, that doesn't mean you can't go to college and a lot of things can't change, as far as how you think. So that's not necessarily true. But I think people that are exposed to the ideas of freedom and liberty prior to going to college, I don't think that's going to change, or thinking for themselves. But yeah, colleges, and I haven't been for a while now. But like, what, over 10 years, we'll say. Not that much over 10 years, though. So my point being that there's a lot more to, I had to log back into my computer. This fucking thing, the screen saver comes on way too quick. I need to change that. And I always say I'm going to change it, and I never do. And it's where I monitor. It's the computer that's going out to all of you live, and I'm monitoring the levels, which is, of course, another thing I do, because it's just me in my little studio here. But I think sports, like I said, college especially, because you have, how will this person do under pressure? How will they get together as a team and respond? How will, you know, in college, most of these players are not going to play football again. The majority of them are not. I mean, look at Division I alone. For people that aren't familiar with college football, Division I, which is the highest division, has, I believe, they keep adding teams because conferences keep stealing teams. The way it's set up is they have what they call conferences, and they have teams within the conference. And the majority of your games are against teams within your conference, but then you have either three or four, depending on the conference you're in, games against other teams from other conferences. And then you have bowl games, and then they have a playoff now, which is stupid because it's only four teams. It should be at least eight minimum, if not 16. I think it should be 16, but that's just me. But the division below them has, you know, playoffs with a lot more teams. I'm not even sure how many, because I don't really follow that division. But the number one division, the one with the people that go to the NFL, not that people in other divisions don't. The backup quarterback for the Patriots, who is a winning what, two games before he got hurt, who was backing up Tom Brady, came from, I believe, Eastern Illinois, which was a Division II, essentially, team. I think they call it Division I AA or FCS. Anyway, so for people that don't know, you learned a little about college football. But the other thing is that they have something like 128 teams, last time I checked. It might be 130 in just in Division I, which is the better division. So of those 130 teams, we'll say, they have bigger rosters than what they have in pro football. And they also like redshirt people, which means, it's funny, I didn't know, used to know what this meant. It means sorry, I was reading a text, that they sit out a season because you only have 4 years eligibility, but you can't, that doesn't mean you can't play past a certain time. Like, so technically I could play football, college football, because I never played. But if you, in your freshman year, a lot of times, depending on their players, they may redshirt somebody, they'll call it. So they'll be part of the team technically, but they won't play that year. Because, say, they don't think they're ready to play yet, or if you have, say, a senior quarterback or something, and, you know, or a junior quarterback, and you know they're going to start the next 2 years, and this guy's a quarterback, and you don't want to waste a year yet. You want to wait another year or for whatever reason. So the point being that you, most of these guys are never going to play again because there might be 80 guys on a team or something, some ridiculous number. There's only a certain amount of scholarships that they allow, but there's something like 80 guys on a team, I believe. It could be between 70 and 80, but there's a lot. So of those, and then you have 130 teams, essentially, what, maybe 1% go to the NFL, I would think, because that would be what, say you got like 8,000 players, but that's, you know, at one time, and then more players keep coming, and maybe, no, it's probably more than that, but we'll even say, even if you say 10%, no, that's too many. Say 5%, whatever. It's not a big percentage. And then you also have the Canadian League. You have the Arena League. So there's other places to play, but they don't get the same amount of money. But even if you count those, I mean, the amount of players that continue to play football after college is it's very small. So you have these guys going out there that are playing for not much more than the love of the game. I mean, a lot of them are scholarship players, so they're playing for their scholarship, but it doesn't mean if they don't play extra hard that they're going to lose their scholarship. You know what I mean? So a lot of these players, though, are going out there busting their ass just because they love the game. So unless you had robots that had emotions, I guess, I don't think people would want to watch robots play sports because of those factors. Then when you get to the pros, it gets more about money, but I mean, they still want to win and they still don't like losing and they want to, you know, play well, and you still have all the other factors, the mental factors and stuff like that. If you had a player that didn't feel pressure, didn't feel any of that shit, then, you know, what would it matter? They'd always play to their potential every single time. as opposed to now, you know, there's things that go on, there's things that happen, people have better weeks than others. And when they play games, there's upsets where a more talented team loses to a less talented team. So all those things that factor in can't be replicated by a robot. So, but you could have robot, but it seems like you already have them. So robot reporters and robot news writers. And I heard they even have this already, that they're generating news stories. I don't know how this works, but like by computer. So I don't know if they feed the facts in and it generates the story, and if they're generating scripts for reporters that way. I honestly don't know enough about it, but I did hear something to that effect. But yeah, you could have, I mean, they fucking sound like robots anyway. You know, the welcome to Channel 7 News. I'm a robot. Or, you know, robot fucking DJs on the stations that you're listening to 107.5 and we're robots. So they could replace things in the media. Of course, they could be more controlled that way. But if you have something like that going on where robots are competing for jobs and relationships, and they become almost a subset of humans where they're almost considered people. I remember, what was the movie, Short Circuit, where number Johnny Five, where they had Johnny Five became human, basically. I mean, he didn't look like one. He was like this big, huge fucking robot that would roll down the street. But he became a human as far as mentally. He was like a human. He had emotions. He had the brain capacity to think like a human, to not just to store data and recite it or be able to regurgitate it. He could think and analyze and all of these things. So that's another thing too. It sounds like schools, right? That it reminds me of schools in that schools mostly have you memorize shit and then just regurgitate that information, as opposed to you reading or learning something and then having questions that make you think about what you just read and analyze it. And but that's a whole nother issue. So will that force, and this is really the only part I'm going to cover about transhumanism, but will people be forced to merge with machines in order to compete? And then there's the other question that we kind of talked a little about yesterday, because we were talking about communism and the story Harrison Bergeron, which I've mentioned a couple times in the past. I think this week I mentioned a couple times that Harrison Bergeron, they tried to make everybody equal. I'm not going to go through the whole story again, but so like physically, and they, you know, try to control people's intelligence through machines or bands that they'd wear on their head, like shit like that. So they could force equality through transhumanism, as well as people being forced to merge with machines in order to compete with other machines. Meaning that if we get to a level in society, like I said, that machines become, or robots become like people, that they have emotions and they have all of these things, and people actually look at them humans actually look at them like people. One, it kind of almost defeats the fucking purpose, I guess, except for the fact that they could live forever. But what, in that sense, what would be the point? And I know somebody would do something like that just to show that they could do it, right? Like, someone would want to create, hey, I want to be able to create a robot that's just like a human and has all the qualities of a human mentally and emotionally and whatever. But what is the point of that? That's where you get into territory where, is there a purpose to do that? Or will that just end up developing on its own? Because there is a point to have robots that are learning, that are able to learn, because that will help you if you have robot workers or robot, I guess, relationships or whatever the robots are being used for. I didn't even get into the military yet, you know, robot spies or robot, you know, the military could use robots in so many different ways. But besides it just developing into that, what would be the point? And if robots developed all the traits of humans, they'd also develop the negative traits of humans. And robots being more powerful, would they try to take over? And would that again force people into transhumanism and to merge with machines themselves to be able to keep up with robots? So we're going to take a quick break. I have some clips to play. And when we come back, we'll talk more about robots. We'll talk about how it will affect government, freedom, especially, and even things like policing and how that will affect, you know, once you have robot police, what happens then? Because right now, and as I talk about all the time, I mean, the level of freedom, it is almost non-existent in my opinion, and it's all an illusion. But if we were somehow able to convince people in law enforcement of the truth and the military, which is a little different, where a lot of them are a lot more open to a lot of these things and they only believe in fighting in other countries and stuff like that. But even with them, that you can try to convince them of, you know, what the government's doing and all of this stuff. But once you go to robots, and if it's initially, of course, mindless robots that are programmable, that are going to obey the government, not talking about the robots that I was mentioning that are, you know, I think the robots that I was talking about that would be just like a human, meaning having human emotions and all of that stuff. And I mean, not being able to act like they have human emotions, actually having human emotions and all of that, is, I think, something like that is hundreds of years away at minimum. Having a robot that can learn and looks like a human, I don't think is that far away. But getting to the point where you have robots that you would consider people, and then, like I said, it would defeat the purpose, I think that is way really far off. But having robot police, like RoboCop or something, or even the other things they tried to develop in the RoboCop movies, I don't know how far off that is. And they're starting with these military robots. And when we get to that point, you can't reason with those things. You can't tell them how, you know, the government is violating your freedoms and whatever, and try to convince them to give, you know, not be a cop or, you know, not oppress people. So that's when I think things would get real scary. So we'll talk about that and more when we come back. Remember to check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. That's nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And we'll be back right after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
Are you looking for a podcast that talks about life, the universe, and everything? Listen in to the Illumination Hour, Monday nights, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. Listen live at Spreaker.com or NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. We're also on SoundCloud, Spreaker, Twitter, Tumblr, YouTube, and iTunes. The Illumination Hour, brought to you by Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, and your host, Ellen Stallone. Because a spark can illuminate the world.
I'm Margaret Howell reporting for Infowars.com. We've seen the Black Lives Matter movement in the news lately, more so than ever the past week, in relation to the deaths of Philander Castile and Alton Sterling at the hands of police officers. Now, before we get into the specifics of police shootings and these deaths, I want to play you the president's response to these killings. Take a look.
When incidents like this occur, there's a big chunk of our fellow citizenry that feels as if, because of the color of their skin, they are not being treated the same. And that hurts. And that should trouble all of us.
Now, unlike the liberal opportunistic freaks on the left and the neo-Nazis on the right, we actually care about all lives. We care about Black people getting shot and killed unjustly in this country, of course. And I hate to see cases like this, but we heard our president use a very troubling narrative. He's race baiting. He's inciting more violence by using the narrative that he is and making this a race issue, making this a one-sided problem and fueling the anger. Now, I want to take you to my second clip. It's of the Dallas shooting, this happening last night, where five police officers were killed. Take a look at this footage. We saw that horrific footage where a sniper actually gunned down five police officers that were attending to a protest scene. And the troubling issue here is that we're seeing a push now for the federalization of all local police officers in this country. And I want to take you to my third clip. It's a clip of a local sheriff. He told Megyn Kelly that he thinks that federalization of the Chicago police is in order because they're causing a murder crisis. Take a listen to what he has to say.
I'm trying to figure out why a state of emergency hasn't been declared in parts of the city of Chicago, why there's no curfew in place from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. The first thing they need to do is stem the violence at nighttime. Somehow they have to stop the bleeding, but Rahm Emanuel seems incapable of doing this. I just need to know how many more Black people have to be shot and killed, like Director Comey said, before somebody thinks that this is an emergency.
Now, Sheriff Clark isn't alone in calling for martial law in cities, which aligns with the narrative that we should federalize, nationalize our police force. Al Sharpton has the same sentiment. I brought his clip for you. Take a look at what he says.
There must be national policy and national law on policing. We can't go from state to state. We've got to have national law to protect people against these continued questions.
We hear Al Sharpton akinning the national policing legislation to the Civil Rights Act, and he says there must be a national policy, a national law on policing. We can't go from state to state. We can't trust states with their own laws and regulations. We need to federalize this. We need to step this up and take control of it. Now, that's in line with what the president is trying to do. He's picked six cities to have nationalized police forces. This is his pilot program. $5 million of U.S. taxpayer money has been used to do this. It was launched by Eric Holder so that the DOJ could bring police departments under federal control. Now, the call to nationalize our police force and institute martial law in cities to protect citizens from their own police officers, that falls in line with hacked messages of the Black Lives Matter leader, who these messages actually reveal that the administration has a plan for a summer of chaos and even martial law. I want to read you some of these hacked messages. And on Friday, June the 10th, someone hacked into the Twitter account of hashtag Black Lives Matter, the leader and former Baltimore mayoral candidate, DeRay McKesson. And this is what was leaked, according to this one document, this interaction where the attorney general, it's alleged that the attorney general is planning a summer of chaos to cause disruption at the conventions and ultimately institute martial law. Now, this exchange of messages between DeRay McKesson and a lady named Johnetta Elzey, this is what the conversation included. J.E., have you spoken with Ms. Lynch, Attorney General, recently about the plan for summer and fall leading up to the elections? To which he replies, we spoke 2 weeks ago. They want us to start really pushing how racist Trump is now instead of waiting so that others can start getting the protests ready to shut both conventions down. Then the conversation continues. If we can get both conventions shut down for messing over Bernie and for having racist Trump, then get martial law declared so Obama can stay in office, we will win. Call you soon when I get to my dad's so I can have his landline and we can talk about this more. So the summer of chaos that they're speaking of, they go on to detail how they're bussing people in to create riots. 2,000 people bussed in from different cities and another 6 to 8,000 expected to drive into Cleveland for the convention. They're hoping to cause such mass chaos that martial law has to be declared, possibly even not an election. Who knows? But at least Obama gets to stay in office, according to these leaked tweets between the two of them regarding our own U.S. Attorney General Loretta Lynch. Now, this goes hand in hand with the nationalized police force pilot program that's being instituted currently. And if martial law is declared, we might not even see an election. Well, a federal system of policing would be a good idea in theory if we could just ignore all of the problems and elements associated with federal law enforcement lately. That aside for a moment, what we know from these tweets, from this leaked information, is that mass chaos is planned all through the summer, centered around the election, right up until the election. And if they can manage to stop or halt it and declare this martial law as DHS has implemented the plan of nationalized police forces, they just might get away with it. Meanwhile, our president is making this a race issue, pointing out how police brutalize disproportionately Black people. And this could be a front for pushing a nationalized police force and ultimately declaring martial law. I'm Margaret Hell, reporting for InfoWars.com.
People desperate for staples like milk, rice, and flour stormed a supermarket warehouse in Guyana City.
If you go back to 2007, the British Ministry of Defense came out and echoed a Department of Defense report saying that they believe there would be massive multi-100% food price increases worldwide, and that during that global meltdown, that there would be incredible social unrest that would depopulate much of the earth. Now, Vice magazine and other publications are reporting on a 2015 report produced by the U.S. government, the U.N. Cut. Let's stop it right there. I shot that video, that special, about a week and a half ago, before Hillary Clinton was basically given free rein in the United States of America to break any law she wants. Before more news came out of food riots intensifying in Asia, Latin America, Africa, the Middle East, you name it. Before we got more news of NATO plans to encircle Russia with more troops. Bottom line, ladies and gentlemen, the world financial economy is melting down by design. Everything the globalists are doing is about making us dependent on them. That's why declaring personal independence, I am announcing that we're extending the record sales of 20 to 40% off on water filters and X2 survival shield and, of course, the survival food. I'm extending the 20 to 40% off for one more week, and then that's it. But I'm expanding it when it comes to non-GMO heirloom seeds, all sorts of systems to jump your car or to give yourself power during emergencies, and on solar panel systems and on shortwave radios that are solar powered and crank powered. So we're going from a few dozen items that are discounted to more.
What's the mindset of these mammoth corporations who are now apparently in partnership with government?
Eric Schmidt is Google's CEO.
People are treating Google like their most trusted friend. Should they be?
If you have something that you don't want anyone to know, maybe you shouldn't be doing it in the first place.
Google has already been caught and fined for systematically hacking and harvesting passwords from millions of private Wi-Fi networks with its mapping cars, and illegally siphoning private data from iPhone users.
We don't need you to type at all, because we know where you are, with your permission. We know where you've been, with your permission. We can more or less guess what you're thinking about.
So Schmidt simply views the invasion of privacy as a way to allow the internet giant to gain more information about you. And then that data will let the search engine help you in your everyday life. Don't you get it? Google is trying to amass a huge amount of personal information about you to help you. Duh.
There's what I call the creepy line, and the Google policy about a lot of these things is to get right up to the creepy line but not cross it. I would argue that implanting things in your brain is beyond the creepy line.
Mine in particular.
Yes, at least for the moment, until the technology gets better. Let's talk a little bit about information and search.
Wait a minute, what was that?
I would argue that implanting things in your brain is beyond the creepy line.
Mine is.
At least for the moment, until the technology gets better.
Is he saying that Google's creepy line is defined only by the current level of technology? What does a higher level of technology have to do with morals or ethics?
But what I learned in Silicon Valley was there is no moral component to technology unless humans insist that it be there.
Final robotic Olympic event, the obstacle course. On your marks.
Well, I got down. Now can I get up?
Get set.
The day of living like the Jetsons, mechanized maid, and all gets closer all the time. Here are 10 great robots, some of which are even available to the public. Number 10, Honda's Asimo. The humanoid robot stands a bit over 4 feet and weighs in at 119 pounds. But its developers have packed a whole lot of functionality into its modest frame. Asimo can do sign language, play soccer, and even serve drinks. Number 9. Karatus. If you ever dreamed of being the pilot of a great big robot, this is your chance. Located within its 13-foot-tall frame is enough room for an onboard commander. Oh, by the way, it can be controlled with an iPhone. Number 8. Atlas. Commissioned by the Pentagon and engineered by Boston Dynamics, this disaster rescue dynamo is built to perform the heroic task of saving lives without risking its own. Number 7. Termite robots. These little guys are designed to do tough, tedious building work, and their way of working was inspired by termites. The bots assess their environment, take cues from one another, and get to work even though they haven't a clue of the bigger plan. Number 6. Cheetah Cub. Wanting to know how to make robots take control of tough terrain with the grace of a feline, scientists at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology made a robotic cat. Using it, they can assess joint force and agility without having to harm an actual animal. Number 5. Wildcat. Not to be confused with the aforementioned Cheetah Cub, the Wildcat is the newest generation of Boston Dynamics' Cheetah robot line. These machines are made for speed, traveling up to 29 miles per hour. While previous versions were indoor sorts, this one is suited to run free. Number 4. VGO Virtual Student. Stuck at home with a severe immune disorder, a student in Texas is now able to attend classes thanks to a robot. She can power the virtual version of herself via internet and participate in what's going on thanks to a webcam.
Miranda suffers from a weak immune system that doesn't allow her to attend class in person, but thanks to this robot pilot program, she's back in the classroom.
Number 3, Robofly. It's tiny and fast, weighing only 80 milligrams and flapping its wings up to 120 times per second. Once technology advances and can make it a battery small enough, the robotic insect is predicted to be a helpful tool in search and rescue missions. Number 2, the MAB. It flies around your house, senses where it's dirty, and then deploys a bunch of tiny little cleaning bots to make the area sparkle. It's just a concept, but was enough of one to win the Electrolux Design Lab competition. Number 1, Curiosity. NASA's Mars rover has accomplished far more than any other robot can imagine, so to speak. It's only been on the red planet for about a year and a half, but has already determined that there could have once been life there. If you could design a robot, what would you make it do?
Topping off a week of robotic demonstrations, commercial companies showed off their weaponized robots to U.S. Army officers at Fort Benning in Georgia on Thursday. Robotics companies like Northrop Grumman, 5D Robotics, iRobot, and HDT Robotics demonstrated how well their machines could move over rough terrain, carry hundreds of pounds of supplies, and follow soldiers on the move. On Thursday, four of the companies demonstrated how their robots, equipped with M240 machine guns, could accurately fire at targets 150 meters away. Military leaders were looking to see what the technology is capable of and how it could be used on the battlefield.
We think it will increase the standoff distance of soldiers actually from hostile fire. And we think with the possibility that we can save lives, and it's a great force protection multiplier.
The robotics demonstration also included several days of putting the robots through their paces on what the Army called an autonomy course. The robots maneuvered through a wooded area, a water course, and up a rocky hill. Many of the machines were able to act without being tethered to a human controller. They could follow a person through the course or be controlled by a handheld device or a laptop computer.
Autonomy gives you the ability to get that machine where you need it and get it there without a lot of task load on a soldier. They can concentrate on the environment around them, and that's how you stay alive. That's how you keep them alive.
Army officers said they are not currently using weaponized robots in the field, but are interested in being able to equip troops with the robots. A robot could be set up to fire machine guns, grenades, or even anti-tank missiles, giving the troops cover and heavy firepower. The robots also use thermal imaging systems to help soldiers identify enemy positions. While the robots could be equipped with weapons, Army leaders said they don't foresee the robots being able to act alone. For the foreseeable future, there will always be a soldier in the loop, making the ultimate decision about when to fire. With additional reporting in Fort Benning, Georgia by Sharon Godden, this is Keith Shaw, ComputerWorld.com.
The end of cash is near. We've covered this before here at PFT, and in a nutshell, it's basically a problem-reaction-solution analysis. They nationalized the monetary system, which is a huge problem. We reacted by demanding more statism, which perpetuated the problem and now has created the proposed solution, which is a cashless society. But how are they going to justify banning cash? I mean, perhaps the next crash in the business cycle is going to be blamed on hoarding stockpiles of cash. We know the big banks and corporations are sitting on cash reserves. And the social justice, environmentalist, eugenics, leftist crowd are likely going to welcome a confiscation of this wealth. In fact, the move to a cashless society is really just one large step towards actual communism. Now, the central banks should not be setting interest rates at ridiculously low levels. It discourages savings and it encourages debt creation. And as we can see in Canada, or the US, or Japan, or Europe, this method of economic growth is really just asset inflation, which leads to recessions and ultimately depression. So their solution is lower interest rates until they're at zero, and then it's negative interest rates. We basically already have that here in Canada. I mean, just ask yourself if your bank or your credit union charges you more each month than you receive in interest. Now, historically, when governments mess around with the economy like this, people respond by hoarding their money. Now, if that money is paper, governments then respond by creating massive inflation and thereby forcing people to spend their money before it becomes completely worthless. Now, it doesn't necessarily quite work like that in our system today, so central banks are now responding by literally eliminating cash. The government wants all cash in the banks, so every transaction can be monitored, regulated, and completely controlled. Imagine the entire world recorded in one giant online ledger, controlled and monitored by a hierarchy of technocrats and self-serving bankers. Eliminating cash may happen after one of the next financial crises. I mean, bailouts have proven to be unpopular, so now there's even talks of bail-ins. We've covered this here before on PFT with Cyprus and the Canadian connection. You see, a bail-in means that when a bank fails, it will reach into its depositors' accounts before accepting any money from taxpayers. And to keep fiat money in the banking system where the state can get to it, some economists have advocated banning cash. And some countries have already done so. Italy made cash transactions over 1,000 illegal. Switzerland is proposing banning cash payments in excess of 100,000. Russia banned cash transactions over 10,000. Spain banned cash transactions over 2,500, and Mexico made cash payments of more than 200,000 pesos illegal. Uruguay banned cash transactions over 5,000, and France made cash transactions over 1,000 illegal, down from the previous limit of 3,000. Denmark has also made moves towards a cashless society. They're not part of the euro, and they have their own currency called the krone. And the Danish government is proposing to scrap cash as a cost-saving measure. Even a member of German Council's economic experts is calling for a cashless society. He said it would be a good subject for the agenda of the G7 summit. And as for Canada, we're already well onto that road. An RBS report from 2011 found that the world average for paying by plastic amounted to 40% of transactions, but the rate in Canada was 68%, making us the world leader in people who are voluntarily going cashless. We also don't have a penny anymore, so the precedent has been set to get rid of nickels and quarters. And, I mean, how far is this cost-saving measure argument going to reach? I mean, perhaps we better just get rid of all coins and all paper money to stop the drug dealers and the terrorists. The Royal Canadian Mint has actually looked into digital currencies, and although they later abandoned the project when it became clear that the state is not going to be able to duplicate Bitcoin. In fact, the whole point of the Bitcoin scheme is that it is independent from state involvement. Canada's Interact system is the world leader in digital fiat transaction systems. You can pay by debit card at a cash register or pay user fees at a bank machine. In the US, these kinds of transaction systems would be owned by the banks, and they usually charge fees on customers or impose cost on retailers. But the not-for-profit Canadian Interact costs so little that it overtook cash as the Canadian standard. A PayPal survey found that 71% of Canadians are ready to go cashless. And an RBC Shoppers Drug Mart poll found that 76% of Canadian women typically carry less than $50 on them, compared to 66% of men. And as Wayne Bossert, former executive vice president of RBC, says, "We are increasingly becoming a cashless society. Canadians are recognizing that debit is a convenient way to pay, and now they can earn reward points on debit purchases that translate into savings. Reward points on debit cards. As in, like, air miles and PC or shopper points. And all those other fake numbers that translate into cheaper groceries or movie theater tickets or whatever. You see, these fake reward points are not savings at all. They're just tokens in a phony economy where goods and services are provided by the corporate state apparatus. As the Canadian Bankers Association works on a unified, standardized system for smartphone payments in Canada, something that is likely going to evolve into a interact for smartphones, analysts are all agreeing that within just a few years, our smartphones are going to be completely merged with our wallets. And I mean, greater advancements in technology are generally welcomed with open arms. Being able to pay for goods and services with your phone is a temptation that I don't think too many people are going to decline. You know, it's that classic problem-reaction-solution method that we've come to expect from the American elites. Their solution to the stock market crash in the early 2000s was to lower interest rates and thereby creating another problem. And the masses reacted to the bust in 2008 and 2009, and the solution provided was more government intervention and even lower interest rates. And now the Fed is stuck at zero and quantitative easing just to keep everything afloat. But floating on what? I mean, the dollar's value is determined by a cartel of bankers and people's willingness to keep the casino going. The solution the elites provide in Canada and the U.S. is devaluing the currency, keeping interest rates low, and in effect, wiping out the pensions and the retirement savings of the elderly, to name at least one group that's being affected. Everyone sees the effect of a nationalized monetary system when we go to the grocery store. Now, what will bring about this North American Union, according to the elites, is the breakdown of this system. Only then will there be any justification for locking our cash inside the electronic banking system. Goods and services will increasingly become rationed, not according to some free market pricing system, but the central planning grid of the authorities. And when money has become completely electronic, that is, just nothing but numbers on your phone, well, the international banking system will have complete control of money. And they will be able to just debit and credit individual accounts at will. The entire market order will be supplanted, and it will be de facto communism. But hopefully not on my watch. Thanks for watching, folks. Check out the links in the description for all the sources to this video.
When you think about driverless vehicles, you most likely think about Google. The company has put its stamp on the revolutionary technology that's expected to act both as your car and as your chauffeur. But even though Google has the most notable driverless car, it's certainly not the only driverless vehicle on the market. Defense industry heavyweight Lockheed Martin has just wrapped testing on a slightly bigger driverless prototype. It looks a little something like this. Yes, that's a military truck. At demonstrations earlier this month at Fort Hood, Texas, the U.S. Army and Lockheed Martin showed off their new system that allows Army convoys to operate independently in foreign urban environments. Using something called the Autonomous Mobility Applique System, or the AMAS, the vehicles can dodge pedestrians as well as navigate oncoming traffic, road intersections, and stalled vehicles. This advanced system is all a result of an $11 million contract between the Army and Lockheed Martin, wherein the defense contractor is developing low-cost sensors that can be attached to existing Army machinery. Without a driver, the trucks will be able to enter foreign areas and combat zones without having to worry about the danger of risking American soldiers' lives. However, if desired, the vehicles can still be manned. In that case, the truck would alert the soldier to any safety threats, and then the driver would have the ability to stop, adjust, or take full control of the vehicle. But the AMAS system only moves the military closer to its goal of capitalizing on autonomous warfare. Last month at the Army Aviation Symposium, an officer announced that the Army was looking to slim down its personnel numbers and adopt more robots over the coming years. The officer was suggesting that the Army move to incorporate the robot mule, an autonomous vehicle that can transport supplies and heavy loads for soldiers. But as we've learned in recent months, it goes far beyond that. Take a look at this animation from Sandia National Laboratories. This is the future of automated drones, a single unmanned vehicle that can fly, swim, drive, and even jump 30 feet into the air. This is being developed right now. The government contractor says it hopes the device will one day carry out missions usually reserved for special operation forces. So from automated trucks to mules to drones, unmanned and autonomous systems are no longer a technology of the future, at least not for the U.S. military, which is seemingly moving to prepare for war in the robotic age. In Washington, Amira David, RT.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And of course, check out the Illumination Hour every Monday, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. That was a great commercial that Ellen Stallone had put together for her show that we aired during the break there. That's the only commercials I guess I really air is the commercial for her show. And I want to actually do some more stuff. Oh, I just like burped. Excuse me. Some stuff for my show as well. You know, the lead ins and outs. So anyway, during the break, I played some clips, a couple about the military and their weapons. And of course, that's the main, when it comes to government, you know, that's the main thing that they want robots for. They want military weapons. They want different types of robots that they can use. In the shootings in Dallas, they used a robot to go and like explode a bomb or something, and they've been using those. So even police are using robots, not the really the type of robots that we are trying to focus on tonight, but it does fall into the robot category. As I said originally, I wanted to focus more on human robots or cyborg type robots that had human, basically a robot that looked like a human that you wouldn't know, and that even had at least the capacity to act like they had emotion. Not that they had emotion, because again, that would defeat the purpose. But also when it comes to working robots and all that stuff, I mean, the one thing, the one big difference between robots and humans, even if robots had emotions and they had all the same mental characteristics, is that they wouldn't get tired, they wouldn't get hurt, they wouldn't feel physical pain, I guess, unless they were programmed that way. But why program them that way? So to have them work other than mental stress or mental boredom or whatever, because those things would obviously affect them. But besides that, they wouldn't have the same issues that a person would have. Like, they wouldn't have to sleep, or they wouldn't, like I said, get tired doing a job or get sore muscles or things like that. So that would be different, I guess. But I don't see, you know, again, what would be the purpose to have a robot that was just like a human in every way, mentally and, of course, physically. That kind of defeats the purpose. And what is the purpose of creating robots is, I would think, to have them do tasks. The main thing, I think, would have them, you know, to automate different things, to have them to be able to do work that humans don't want to do. And, of course, the military is to have, you know, weapons. But I don't know. I mean, it's just like everything else where you have a positive and negative side to it. And I definitely see the positive side, but I see the negative side. So you look at how would it affect, say, freedom? And it could affect it in a number of ways where the government could use robots as spies. They could use robots to track you, to watch you. So instead of having CIA agents or agents around, which I believe they do, that are just in neighborhoods observing people, reporting people, things like that, they could just have robots that do that. And you wouldn't know they were robots. You'd think it's just your next door neighbor, but it's a robot. So as far as the surveillance state, that is already out of control, even though people just pretend that it doesn't exist, which I still don't get. And I think about even the debates. And unfortunately, the next and final debate is going to be here in Las Vegas at UNLV. And I just found out today one of our meetings got moved to another. I don't want to get too specific, but they'll have to. It's just an inconvenience, it being here. That has to do with work. But as I said, you know, I have a job where I work independently a lot and stuff like that. So I'll listen to, you know, I'll always have headphones on, because if I didn't, I'd probably go nuts. I mean, especially, you know, some days I won't even talk to anybody, not on purpose. It's just I'm working on like a report and that's what I'm doing all day. So it, without, you know, something to listen to, I'd probably go nuts. But anyway, so I mentioned how I heard the debates, you know, and not as much as somebody watching it, because, you know, I'm listening while I'm working, so I'm not catching everything. But what I did catch, even, and I did the same thing with the other debates, you know, I it was something to listen to. So I listened to the Republican debates and the town halls and the Democrats debates as well. Well, which was really just Hillary and Bernie Sanders for the most part, but not much came up about spying and not much of the truth. That's the other thing about these debates that I had mentioned yesterday, that they keep asking, when they ask questions, these moderators, they're asking questions that aren't even factual. So like one of the questions in one of the debates had to do with Assad gassing the quote unquote rebels, which are really just terrorists, but that's been proven that it's not true. But they act like it is. So they keep, you know, it's really getting to a 1984 type world when it comes to news. In people who haven't seen the movie 1984 or read the book, I didn't read the book, I just saw the movie, which I had mentioned. I really didn't think it did. The book is probably much better, but it wasn't hard hitting enough to me. And maybe I need to watch. I've seen it a couple times. I have the DVD. Maybe I need to watch it again. But it just, I don't think it was hard hitting enough. Just like I said about the Snowden movie, and you know, going back to spying, that Oliver Stone did a great job with JFK. I think if you haven't seen that movie, you should see that movie, not only because of how powerful it is and how, you know, that's going to hit you, but it's based mostly on all factual events. The majority of the movie, you know, I don't know about like his family life. Like, that's the type of stuff that they might dramatize, as far as Garrison, Jim Garrison, the district attorney who was the only one ever to bring a case against the murder of John F. Kennedy. Like, his wife was going to leave and they were having argument, whatever. I don't know about that part. And then, you know, of course, with his staff and how they interacted. But as far as facts relating to the case, it's a very powerful movie. And if you believe that Lee Harvey Oswald killed Kennedy, then I don't think you'd believe any conspiracy ever. You know, if you don't at least believe that was a government involved murder plot, or at least that the story of Lee Harvey Oswald being the lone gunman is bullshit. If you don't believe that, then you won't believe anything that has to do with false flags or conspiracies. I truly believe that, because there is so much evidence and it's just so obvious as to why and how and just all of these things. And they even admitted later that Oswald worked for the CIA or the FBI or something. And I think CIA, they admitted that Clay Shaw, who was the guy who he brought the case against, worked for the CIA or was a CIA asset later. So, I mean, it may be that people don't know that part of it, but some people, it doesn't matter. They think, well, the government wouldn't do that. And how they get to that point, that they get that far, I don't know. But my point was that JFK is a very powerful movie. But Snowden, to me, and it may be just because of what I know at this point and what I believe and all of that, but he kind of said that, though, as well, that it was more, you know, he didn't want to get too technical, and that was part of the reason. But it just, to me, it wasn't as hard-hitting a movie as it should have been or could have been. And I think people will just see it and just continue on with their lives like they're doing right now. Now, what do I expect people to do? I don't know. I do expect people to be outraged. And the way this, I guess, relates to our conversation tonight is, you know, one of the things that I wanted to talk about is the future and not just the future 100 years from now, but, you know, the future 20 years from now, whatever. And if they have the technology they have now with spying, they're definitely going to have more of that. And, you know, it's not just the, I was talking in terms of robots. So let me go through that first, and then I'll get more into the future in general. But as far as robots and government, I think, you know, just like they do with everything else, they're going to be used for not only spying on people, but of course, CIA spying on other countries. I mean, they've been trying to create superhuman, like these comic book characters. I mean, they really want people like that. That's not a fucking, you know, joke. I mean, they tried all these experiments first in brainwashing with MK Ultra, and that was more just being able to brainwash people, which I think it's semi-proven that they've been able to do the Manchurian Candidate thing. If you look at Sirhan and all the stuff that he had said, and he's the one who was arrested for murdering Bobby Kennedy, although they say that it didn't look like it even came from his gun, that it was somebody else that actually did the shooting. Who knows? But he didn't remember even doing it. And for somebody to come up with something like that is, you know, who comes up with a defense to a murder and says that? And I don't know, you know, I'm not saying that's what he said in his defense at the trial, because I don't know what the defense at the trial was, if it was temporary insanity or whatever. I don't know enough about the case, but I do know at some point whether it was, you know, interviews later, he said he didn't remember any of it. And you have the Reagan, you know, what I called last night, the Reagan hit. So if you are able to do this with regular people, and at some point you can just have robots that look like people do it, that have no identity, that have no feelings, if you, you know, you can create a robot like that, obviously, initially. I, like I said, I was talking about robots with feelings, but, you know, obviously, you can create just a robot assassin, and they'll be untraceable, and then you can dismantle them after they do whatever they do, and it's like they disappeared. So with government and the military, their interest in robots, I think, goes to a whole nother level, and it will affect us in a very negative way when it comes to the government getting hold of that technology. And of course, you know, they're the ones who are funding a lot of it, so they're going to have their hands on all that technology as well. So you look at the government now, and look at what they have technology-wise, and how technology in general is getting so much more advanced. Like, even we talked about one time how hard drives, I mean, every other year it's like doubling or tripling in the amount of, now most hard drives are a terabyte. I remember when I got a computer in 2001 and it was 40 gigabytes, the hard drive. You know, now it's a terabyte. So which I believe is what, a million gigabytes or something. So, I mean, the technology, and that's just hard drives, never mind. Because I think as they figure things out, and there's nanotechnology and all, and that's scary as well, that there's things that are so small that can be inserted into your body. I mean, they could probably at some point, maybe even now, have bug-like things go in, you know, that small, go into your skin or be injected and literally like eat away at your brain or something and cause you to go crazy, or, you know, things like that, where they won't have to kill people through guns or, you know, military, which, you know, of course they don't just do that. I mean, they cause people to have heart attacks and shit like that. But I mean, they'll be able to do it through like other shit, like nanotechnology and all of this other technology that is being, you know, developed. Because who knows how many weapons they're developing through the military to be used for assassinations or this or that, or through the CIA. And of course they're getting all this money through selling drugs, and they have a whole bunch of extra money to invest in technology and spend on that. And it's just, who knows how things are going to be. So going from there, I guess, to the future in general, and what that will be like as far as I had mentioned freedom and the level of freedom, and, you know, how robots will affect that, but just in general, how, what things will be like. And I think we're moving in that direction. Obviously, you know, that's what I talk about all the time, is how the level of freedom, you know, because we all have a certain level of freedom, I guess. You could look at each state or each country or whatever, but it's very low as it is, and it's just going to get lower and lower, and things are moving towards more socialism, more making people equal. And, you know, there's ways through technology to do that, making people equal, whether it's, like I said, you could have, you know, perform operations on people through, you know, little parasites or nanotechnology or whatever to target parts of their brain to make them all stupider, or all equal average intelligence, that everybody has average intelligence. Everybody has average looks. Everybody has, I mean, and with robots, you could do that too. So through transhumanism, that would be a way of making everybody equal, put everybody in the same fucking body, basically. Or you have maybe, you know, a selection of 10 different, you know, bodies, but they're all, or whatever, a certain amount, but they're all, you know, the same level of attractiveness and things like that. And then you make sure through whatever technology they have as far as controlling the amount of intelligence that they have, or limiting people's intelligence. And I know these, and that's kind of what Harrison Bergeron was. And I know that people probably, you know, think, well, that's just nuts. That's not going to happen and whatever. And, you know, I don't know how far out some of these things are. You know, you read some stuff and it seems like it's coming very soon. And then you look at other things, and, or you even look at like businesses and how their technology should be so much more advanced than it is, you know? And I have seen that at a lot of companies that I've worked for, you know, where their technology was so, I guess, behind where I thought it should be with, you know, looking at, well, it's, you know, 2016 and you would think that the technology should be here, but it's only here. You know what I mean? So to to look at that and even see that it's not where it should be. I mean, what about everything else? You know, I mean, how fast is this technology actually going to materialize into something that people are using or that the government is using and that is, you know, mass produced or whatever, or mass produced by the government when it comes to things like, you know, robot police or whatever, or the technology of having cameras in your house that connect to the local police station or the fusion centers or, and I see that, you know, not that far out neither, where there was one town where I don't even know if it was a town or it was just a housing development where they wanted everybody to get cameras or something, or they had cameras. It was something where it might have had to do with the HOA, but they wanted the police to have access to the cameras. And they're doing that in a lot of places like New York City, Boston. They're able to, whether I think they have permission or not, that they're tapping into these feeds. Now, some of them, they may have permission or whatever, but some of them they don't. And then they can put a camera anywhere they consider a public place anyway and have that. So they're putting up all these cameras everywhere. And if a sidewalk is public, all you got to do is put a fucking pole somewhere and there you go. I mean, you can have a fucking camera. So it's not that far out of, you know, the realm of possibility of things like this expanding. I mean, they're already here. So if most of these things are already here to a certain extent, which they are, and people are accepting them, and some people are not only accepting them, they're happy for them. Not like that sounds kind of funny, like I'm happy for you that you have cameras. No, but I mean, they're welcoming them because they look at it as protection when it's not. It's just like the people that call the police when their kid is, you know, might have a little mental issue and call the police and the police kill them. I'm lucky I'm not dead because my father called the police on me a bunch of times. Luckily, I either left or I'm trying to remember the specific incidents. You know, it was back a while ago, so it wasn't, and I don't want to say that it wasn't as bad because I'm sure it was just as bad or worse, but I kind of just avoided, I was able to avoid them because he was calling the police for like dumb fucking reasons. Like he was mad and he could like when I was 12, he punched me in the head and then called the police, which was makes no sense. And I just went in my room and like kind of, you know, and when he would call the police, I'd try to just leave the house or, you know, kind of hide type thing so I could avoid them. But I wasn't like flipping out. He didn't call the police because I was doing anything wrong, like flipping out or something like that. It was usually him, the one that was flipping out. So he might be lucky that he didn't get fucking shot by the police. To be honest, and he was a little, you know, darker skinned, not that he was dark skinned, but I mean, darker than the average white person. And he had like Brillo kind of hair, you know, and some people think that he, you know, he could pass for Hispanic. So he should have been kind of a little more careful about that. Luckily, nothing ever happened. But I think, you know, things haven't changed when it comes to police killing people and stuff like that. But things have changed in a sense of if he would have punched me in the head and called the police today when I was I was 12, I think they would have handled that totally differently. He probably would have got arrested. And I don't know that I told him that, but he might have told him that. I can't remember. So, you know, as far as how they handle that, I mean, there was a documentary on last night. I didn't watch the whole thing because I had to go to sleep, but about, and I've talked about this before, about all these kids that are getting arrested for stupid shit, and they're going to jail for stuff that aren't even crimes for adults. You have 6 and 7 year olds, you know, throwing tantrums, and based on that, you know, they're getting arrested. It's insane. And I look at having kids and I'm like, why would I want to subject kids to that environment? And that's why, you know, if I have kids, there's no way that they're going to go to public school. It's not going to happen, or government school. And I think that other people should take them out too. Now, how common is it? I don't know, but I do know having police in schools is pretty common. I don't know the percentage of schools, but from what I understand, it's up in the 90s. Now, there might be small towns that don't, but usually even, I mean, you have the small towns in New Hampshire where there's no crime that the police have the Bearcats and all that shit. So if you, and they have automatic weapons. So if you have that going on, I'm sure you have police even in schools and in towns, like in the middle of nowhere. You know, maybe if you have a school of like 200 kids, you don't have police, but you probably do. You probably have one, but you probably still have police. So the fact that you're going to send your kid to a school with police based on their track record, and it's not bullshit. I know the excuses I hear from fucking people, man. I just, it fucking, you know, it really frustrates me, to be honest. And I don't know if people heard, I forget what show it was from last week, but there was a show where I just fucking went off. I was playing some clips and I just totally went off on those clips because it was such bullshit. And one was from O'Reilly, that fuckhead. But I just, it's, I don't know if I'm just more angry now, which I seriously doubt it, because when I was a kid, I was angry because, you know, I had issues with my father and stuff like that. Actually, it was on last Thursday's show. when we were talking about synthetic drugs. And a lot of people actually listened to that show, so they heard that. So hopefully, hopefully it didn't bother them. But I don't know. But the when it comes down to it, I mean, this shit is fucking ridiculous. I can't help but be frustrated by it. You know, I deal with my frustration by just, you know, talking about it on my show, but I don't understand how other people can listen to this bullshit that people are putting out there and just be fine with it, because that's what it seems like to me. Now, I don't know, because government media obviously isn't going to give you the truth. And there's not a lot of, well, I guess there are, but I don't know how you can trust them or how accurate they are. I was going to say there's not a lot of studies regarding, you know, what people think on some of these things. There are a lot of studies or polls on what people think on certain things, but I don't know that they've done a lot of polls on some of the stuff that I'm talking about and what people think. And you'd have to be very specific, and I'd have to go out and ask people, you know, and ask. I mean, I would get a good sample size being in Las Vegas, because I would get people from all over the country and all different types of people, all different ages, all different political parties or non-political parties or whatever. So it would actually, the strip, if I was on the strip, I mean, or downtown, any place else is going to be, you know, mostly people that live in Las Vegas. But and a lot of people that live in Las Vegas are from different places, but I think it would be best to ask people on the strip if I wanted to get, you know, an opinion. But I mean, how many people can I fucking ask, and what does that even mean? So I don't know how they do these polls, and supposedly they're saying how accurate they are, but they do a small sample size, and from that, they supposedly, you know, tell you what the opinions of the majority of the people are. And to me, it's bullshit. So I'm not saying that other people don't have those opinions, but if they do, I don't see it or hear it. I don't get emails saying that, yeah, I'm frustrated about this too. I get some comments on my like Facebook page or whatever that people agree with me, but it's not like I'm getting a lot. And, you know, you would think that if people really felt that way, that, you know, that'd be something that I'd get more responses. So I, in general, and I've said this before, think that there's more people that are waking up to the government, but there's also more people that are becoming brainwashed by the government at the same time. But of those people that are waking up to the government, and this is something that I haven't talked about, I mean, how many of them disagree with the government because they want communism, or they want socialism? So just because people are fed up with government, you know, you have these right-wing people, like extreme right-wing, that want to take over the government, but then they just want to implement their fucking conservative government or constitutional, but the Constitution doesn't give you the freedom that you're born with neither, so it wouldn't change anything. And anyway, obviously the Constitution doesn't work because they don't follow it. No piece of paper works. If you give people power over you, they abuse that power. That's a fact. It's been proven over and over again. So to kind of get back to what we were talking about regarding the future, I mean, I'm not optimistic about the future at all. I am scared for kids, and, you know, if I have kids, I'll be scared for them. I'm not really worried about myself, not because I don't think things will continue the way they're going, because I do. It's just, I'm not scared. But at the same time, you know, I see things going in the same direction in the future. And I had posted this, but I typed it out. It was a response to somebody, but I didn't even post it. But that no matter who, with the presidency, no matter who becomes president, even if it's a fucking lunatic Trump, and that might be worse, but who knows? I think it doesn't, there really is no better or worse, because it's an agenda that they don't even control. And whoever's in there, it's all rigged, and they are going to follow the, continue with the agenda. You had a Republican president, and then you had a Democrat, and they just continued with the agenda. It didn't make any difference between Bush and Obama. You know, they have little things to try to fight about that are meaningless, or things that in the big scheme of things when it comes to freedom are meaningless, you know, yeah, they'll fight about. But in general, when it comes down to it, there's no difference. It's just passing the baton. Pass the baton to the next person that's going to rule over you. And I don't want a quote unquote leader or ruler or any of that. Human rights, they talk about human rights, and I've talked about this, is not what they say it is. You know, Human Rights Watch or whatever, you know, they don't really, because I think of human rights are the rights you're born with. And they should call themselves something else, because they don't address fucking any human rights. Well, I don't know that that's totally true, because there are governments that are, I guess, you know, doing things to people that they do address, but they address more of an agenda. If I'm thinking of the correct group, like the, you know, Southern Poverty Law Center type people. Who's the other one who their name, I can't think of it right now, but they're just pretty much the same as the Southern Poverty Law Center, but they have a name that makes it sound like they fight for people. But I see the future right now as very bleak, and it's not just from a, you know, an economic standpoint. It's from all, I mean, or it's not just a, from a freedom standpoint. It's from an economic standpoint. It's from basically every aspect you could possibly think of. And part of the, you know, economic side of it is because we don't have a free economy. We don't have free markets. We have a central bank. Well, I shouldn't say we, because I'm not part of that. But the government, the U.S. government, has a central bank. They base everything off of debt. And they want people in debt. They want the, I mean, the economy basically runs off of fucking debt, and it's, it's fucked up. I wish I had something more articulate to say about that, but it's just totally fucked up. So let me just finish with this new show on HBO, Westworld. And I don't know how I feel about it yet. I'm sure you can go back and find the first two episodes. If you have HBO, pretty much everybody now has on HBO on demand. I think the only requirement is that you have HBO. Or with DirecTV, you have to have your TV, I think, hooked up to the internet. But with regular cable, I think you just need HBO. But or you can, I think if you have cable, you can watch it online. Anyway, it's, you know, I don't know what to think of it yet, because these people or these robots, and I think I know where it's going, because it's starting to not treat them like people, but they're having awareness as if they're people. And I don't want to ruin any of the shows if you haven't seen them, but there's a scene where somebody, without going into too much detail, becomes aware of what's going on for a minute. But I think they blank their memories, but they're having dreams of their memories, I think, is what is going on. But it's like they're becoming human for the most part. So I don't know what, usually TV in general, and you're talking about HBO as well, has an agenda. And most TV shows, their agenda is not anti-government or anti-police or pro-freedom, for the most part. So I really don't know yet, from only watching two episodes, where this is going to go and whether it's going to become a metaphor for something else. You know, whether it's a metaphor for, you know, classism or racism or something like that, where the humans rule over the robots, type thing, because they can do whatever they want to them, and they're somewhat conscious, even though they wipe their memories. And it really hasn't got into, you know, how conscious are these robots of what's happening to them. But I don't know. I mean, it's definitely, it's interesting so far. It's entertaining. And I hope it doesn't go to the, you know, like, what's that fucking stupid ass movie where they'll probably make another one? The Purge type thing, where, you know, if you can do whatever you want, you're going to abuse people. Because we're starting to see we're starting to see where and I totally lost my train of thought because I was texting there, where these people, some of them enjoy just, you know, killing people. Killing the robots, because they know they're not people. And then I started to think of video games. And you think about video games, should you feel bad because you want to kill people in a video game? It's not real. It's a video game. So being that they're not real people and they know that they're not people, that they're robots, does it matter? Is that an issue? Or the fact that they look human, act human, and have all these attributes of humans. I think one even cried, actually. Now, I don't know that they're programmed to do that, as I was saying, like to mimic emotions, or whether they actually have emotions. And that's something that's probably going to be flushed out throughout the series. But that's another thing. And the reason why that fucking, you know, they call the second one the Purge Anarchy, because what that was saying was basically, if you, to me at least, if you don't have the government there to keep people in line, people are just going to go nuts and kill people. Because essentially what would happen in reality, if people had a day to do whatever they want, you'd have the real criminals, I think, would go out. You know, people that are criminals all the time would just, you know, do crime out in the open. And the people that aren't criminals wouldn't. It would be the same as any other day. The only difference would be is the people that actually commit crimes all the time. And I'm talking about real crimes, not selling drugs or doing drugs, or I'm talking about actually, you know, killing people, harming people, rape and robbery and, you know, things like that, that they would do it out in the open and not try to hide it. And that would really be the only difference. But besides that, I don't think you'd have people that don't commit crimes anyway, committing crimes, you know, committing crimes that hurt people, you know, things like drugs and whatever, things that all don't apply to the non-aggression principle, or, as I said, you know, interfering with other people's freedoms, you know, as long as you don't hurt anybody else or their property. So that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to thank everyone for tuning in, and thanks everyone for tuning in that tuned in this week, as this is our last show for the week. But remember, we are on 24/7. You can go to the archives and listen to any shows from this week if you missed any. Or you can listen in live, of course, to the live stream where we are currently playing a bunch of old episodes. So we'll go to that right after this. So thanks, everybody. And again, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Have a good night.
Necessary, you need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.